The Bible passages with the book of Exodus, the Old Testament reading, it contains the narration of an event in the life of the people of Israel. God called them out of misery, out of great struggle of their own physical life, spiritual life, and whatever else, emotional, mental. They were in deep, deep difficulties and problems. And God heard their cry, and out of his mercy called them out. And he is leading this people, the people of Israel, by his own mighty arm and power, through this leader whom God chosen, the man Moses. And God did great wonders. You know that. But then here comes this people, after having experienced God supernaturally, every way you can imagine, they are grumbling, murmuring, complaining, losing their heart, losing the sight of God. And they are looking down to their mere little world and lost their heart and mind. And so God intervenes in their situation, and being so merciful to them, though they were complaining, which we all do, right? I do. I don't think there is one day go by, if you want to be honest with you, that you don't complain. I do. Not that I desert God and everybody else around and things that he gave me, but that is the perverted, fallen human nature. To get over that is very difficult. And so God comes, as he comes to you and to me every day, to this people Israel, and having mercy upon them, and again showing to them his demonstration of mercy and grace, and providing them food for the stomach. And for that you gave us a mission also, right? What is the mission of the church? Seeking those who are lost. What does it be lost? Well, lost in sin, lost away from God, no more in peace with God, and running in our own sins and our own desires and fleshly ambitions to be fulfilled, which for many, many are or is the ultimate for their life. But then for people like us, it calls for a mission to take the love of God to this hurting and suffering people and see if I can feed one more person. I can be a help and a blessing a little way, a small way, to this person who don't have even a basic nutritious food one time a day. So when you and I live, we have to see both sides of the coin, not just have one focus in saying all about sin and shame and hunger and thirst and suffering and sickness and I have nothing. No, along with that comes the call of God for you and I to see God a little more deeper way, and then also to take into our life the mission of God to touch the suffering, to touch the needy, to be a helping hand in a little way, small way that you and I can, so that you will be a blessing, or you become a little God, a little Jesus for those people. So here you see people grumbling, murmuring for their physical need, although they have experienced in plenteous, abounding way God and his supply. But then God is not saying, hey, what? Didn't you see what I did all these years or days or months of your travel and journey? I will not. He didn't say that. God is so merciful, slow to anger, full of compassion. All God is all grace. He comes down and provides them. Those people only live for now. Well, I don't want to make that an absolute statement, but probably that is the intention of the passage that we read. They live a life for now. Their stomach, their need, their hunger to be quenched, and they want something to drink and eat. And God, not punishing them, didn't you see how beautiful and wonderful I was and trying to preach at them? No, he was kind. He was so kind. He provided. And what about you and me? I think none of us come from palace, rich home, and people who say, I have so much and I don't know what to do with it. No, all of us, majority of us, have come from very simple, humble, little background. We strive hard and worked hard maybe to be where we are. And God's mercy to our daily needs, food, clothing, health, healing, friends, shelter, water for thirst, food for hunger, a body that is perfect. None of you are handicapped or physically challenged. That's where we put it now. All of us are having perfect body. Every faculty, every member of our body is perfectly fit together. Let us look at that as God's blessing and be able to see not just here and now, but a life beyond. God's mercy and grace for all my needs. Then when we come to the readings from the epistle, we find this great man, Apostle Paul, whom we venerate a lot. And truly, he's supposed to. He says in that portion, Philippians chapter 1, 21 onwards, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. What a profound statement, which all of us caught so many times, and I too have done that. But what does that speak to you? What does that apply to me today, for my life now? How do I take that profound statement of Saint Paul and apply it to my personal life as God desires for me to live this life here on this earth? Sometimes we go for studies, not to serve God. I'm sorry to put it that way. And forgive me for that. But to make a job, to make a profession, and thereby make a money, and thereby find security for my physical life. Here is a man who went to the Bible school or whatever you want to say, whom God called out. And from the moment he was determined to follow Christ the way he called, he was focused. He threw away everything that was for this temporal world. He too was a real man, a real human being, with hunger, thirst, and all kinds of things you and I can imagine. And it is written in the book of Corinthians. What all struggles in the physical, temporal world this man went for, the commitment he made so determinedly to follow Jesus Christ and his call. And then he says, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. When I was praying to God, I don't say it as a vain lip service. When I preach, when I court, when I read, give me a little more grace that I read it with right intent, so that I understand what this saint Apostle Paul is saying with all the depth that there is in, and what my God want me to understand from my reading. And Paul, with this physical body that he had, was at that moment in jail. Can I? I don't know. I'm afraid even to speak that word, to utter that word. Do I? Will I? If a moment comes like that, how would I respond? And all my preaching of all these years, quoting this wonderful Bible verse, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." How will that I reflect and live this life now? It's a question. I'm not going to give you a lot of practical applications, you know that. But I'm trying to provoke you to think. And then all that verses that we read after that, from verse 22 onwards, is a description of how a man, a person who is totally sold out to God, so determined not to live for this temporal world, but be given up for the kingdom and a life beyond the value. So it is not talking about preaching, it is talking about you and I inculcating the value, imbibing the value, the ethic of the kingdom of God. Not then, when we will be in heaven, no. Now, life now here on this earth, I need to live that life so that I express the kingdom. Just for an example, how to look at that. You see, look at verse 27 in that. It says, "Whatever happens, conduct yourself in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, commending as one man for the faith of the gospel." It will take for me 1 hour to teach you from that. So I'm not going to go into all those expositions. But just think in a very practical way. How do I live my life when no one sees me? In the hostel, when no wardens and deans and teachers and people who are over you in authority don't see you, look at you, watch you, what do you do? How do you conduct? What do you say? How do you spend your time? How do you talk to your roommate or your hostel mate or to your neighbor? Simple. You got the answer? And if it is a very weak yes to what God expects, it simply says, "God, I want to come to you and seek your mercy and forgiveness, and please, please, Lord, grant me grace." And he will. So that you and I will grow up, not when somebody looks, our ethic and our manner and our speech and our behavior is so good. No, all the time. Imbibe and grow and live in the values and ethics of the kingdom, not just when we reach heaven, but before we reach heaven, right here in this life. The gospel portion we read, it's a beautiful. I was reading it so many times. And I was saying to myself, "Lord, I don't think I will get time to teach everything that you are trying to tell me." It is true. There's no time. What is it all about in that parable? I just want to put in your mind one statement which we all know and which we all normally caught, at least people like me and Achans, maybe not young people. There is a statement Jesus says in verse 16. "So the last will be first, and the first will be last." And then you read that verse, the last verse of the previous chapter, chapter 19 of the Gospel of Matthew and verse 30. It says, but many who are first will be last, and many who are last will be first. Okay, now turn one page farther or ahead, chapter 22nd of the same gospel, verse 14. It says, for many are chosen or invited, but few are called. Then you turn to Luke Gospel, chapter 13, verse 30. It says, indeed, there are those who are last who will be first, and first who will be last. What is Jesus trying to say? Why is he repeating that kind of a similar statement frequently? Is there something more than just that statement for our personal life for now, so that we live this life with kingdom values, or as Jesus lived on this earth? I think so. See, many of us talk about seniority. I do. Oh, I've been serving God for many, many years, you know. I should be treated this way. I should be paid this way. Ah, then you know what else we will think and say, right? And then if someone who just got saved and got into the church, and if the pastor comes and shake the hand and put him to the front and give him a good nod and introduce him little more than maybe it was due. Oh, someone who was in the church for so many years. I've been an elder for many, many years. I gave to the church. I gave to the pastor. I've been a faithful member of the church. What? You never told me about me like that even one time. Just a man just got saved. He was a drunkard and whatever else you want to add. Now, all of a sudden, you push him up. You serve God not because of your seniority. You serve God not because of the pay you are promised. You don't serve God because of the cadre and the status in which you are put. No, that is not in the kingdom. That is not in the kingdom. Let us be very careful to undo any entertainment of such thoughts in serving God. There is no seniority. There is, you just came. I've been there for many, many years. No, nothing like that. God chose you and me out of his abounding grace. And what you and I got is mere gift from God. It is not because you deserve anything. Oh no, it is because of his abounding grace and gift from God. And I have to die to myself every day. Lord, it is not how much I know. It is not seniority. It is not my experience. It is nothing, nothing, nothing. Make me more like you, to think as you think when I serve. And I feel so sad sometimes. People, not in our church maybe, but in other places I have seen in plenty, who only go when their due in right regard is served, when they are respected. That's not kingdom. And the way we to live here, this life God gave, is simply to trust God and say, God, I'm grateful to you. I'm thankful to you for your abounding grace out of which you called me. You gave me this privilege. It's all your grace. It's your gift. I don't deserve anything. And then when he dispensate reward, when he gives away a reward, you see in that portion, somebody came early in the morning, 6 o'clock, the others came 9 o'clock, the others came 12 o'clock, and still others came 3 in the afternoon. The landowner went and called people many, many different period of the day, okay? And they all came in. But then At the end of the day, when reward was to be dispensated or distributed, what did the landowner said? He called someone, his next man maybe, and said, "You call the last one who came at 3 o'clock, if I put it that way, and give his pay." So the last being given the first pay or the first place. And then the people who came at the very early 6 o'clock or whatever, they've been the last one to get the pay. And what happened? Those came at the last moment of the day and worked an hour or so in the vineyard, got the same pay as equal to those who came and labored all the day. So how do God look at our reward? God looks at our reward not with so much of time and work, but with the quality of the work we do. And we have no right to question God if God honors somebody else little more than someone like us who came early. That is kingdom value. So how do you live now? You live this life now, taking that value, growing in that value, so that you are not misplaced or misfit in representing Christ in this world, but you will have the value, the very nature of God that will reflect and resemble all through your life, in every area of your life, every aspect of our life, so that it is Jesus all the way. It is Jesus all the way. Life, now and beyond. May God give us grace and strength to apply these things to our own little world of life and service. Wherever you and I serve, maybe in the seminary, maybe in the church office, maybe studying in the school or seminary, teaching in the school or working in the hospital, a doctor, a lecturer, or a head nurse, or whatever it is, wherever, whatever kind of service God has called us into, let us ask the Holy Spirit to give us that ability so that it is I growing, representing Christ and his nature and his value in the area and in the work I do, so that others will see Jesus more and they be attracted to Jesus more, and thus the kingdom will expand. May God give us that grace. And that is my prayer for myself. That is my prayer for all of us. So that we appreciate what God gave us and be able to go through this life as God wants. Did Jesus say, "Father, you count all the glory and honor and everything that I have, even when I go to the cross?" No. No, he never said that. He said, "Here I am." And the very fact that someone is hanging like that on the cross tells there is nothing to hold. I have given up everything. And that is what you and I need to do when we come before the table. "Lord, I give up everything of my physical, temporal life and anything in the world and desires. I give up everything I hold as a human, that I deserve certain things in my service for you, for God, in the work of God's kingdom. Or Lord, even when I'm put as a leader or as an in charge somewhere, the way I see others and the way I relate and represent your value, your kingdom. God, help me to get a little more deeper into that as I come, seeing Jesus Christ, your Son, giving up everything. May God bless us and help us and make our life more meaningful, beautiful, wonderful in this world."